that perhaps the solution in Iran is not to have a pride march down Main Street in Tehran, you know, holding up rainbow banners. And I say this with a significant amount of time that I have spent over the last 6 years traveling really to the heart of my own religion, but traveling to what you might consider to be some of the most dangerous places in the world, and dealing with this question of religion and homosexuality. And I was listening to you very carefully, and I realized that October 11th is significant, and there is a need to ask for the rights that have been denied to us, let's say in America. But I also want to say that, specifically talking about religion, that some of our last most bitter battles as people who identify as gay or and all of the other categories are going to be on the front lines of religion. And these are going to be really tough battles. I think much of the gay marriage debate in America today has to do with the Christian church, and some of the last sort of affirmation that we need will need to come from these religious authorities. Talking more specifically about Islam, I do want to point out that sitting here again in a comfortable Western space, we often assume that we can dictate the limits and the boundless possibilities of freedom to people who are living in other countries under very different circumstances. If you see a Jihad for Love, or you know, talk to activists coming from other parts of the world, you realize that is not entirely possible. Within many Islamic countries, for example, as I said, I found homosexuality to flourish, but also the line about morality is very clearly drawn, and sometimes that is not as clearly drawn in parts of Scandinavia, perhaps, but there's the public and then there is the private, and a lot of what you can do in private often exceeds what many of us can imagine. Some of the wildest gay parties I ever went to were in Tehran, for example, and I won't go into details, but so there is, you know, a kind of ability to live your life invisibly, to live and exercise your sexual choices in private, exists and has existed throughout Islamic history. Culturally, of course, has been celebrated. Traditionally, as some of you I'm sure know, you know, Western scholars or Orientalist scholars historically used to look at Islamic societies as dens of vice, as places where all kinds of sins were allowed, where young men were often idolized, and so on and so forth. What I think has happened, and I'm speaking again in very broad terms here, is that in the past century, in the 20th century, the condemnation of homosexuality in many Muslim countries has had a lot to do with the vestiges of colonialism. And I'm coming to a particular point here, but that is when the discussion of homosexuality within Islam has moved from a discussion in the culture, perhaps in the arts, and something that might have been not a religious discussion, into the pulpits, into the bully pulpits of the mullahs in Friday sermons. And that, we have to realize, is a significant shift that is not going to have an easy solution. I feel that many of the laws that exist in parts of the Muslim world, Muslim world actually, are colonial laws, and have been left behind by the French or the British and so on and so forth. You have this in Lebanon, you have this in India, you have this in Pakistan, you have this in Bangladesh, and many other parts of the world. The majority of Muslims in the world are not living under Sharia law and are not, sort of condemned to death immediately, but are living with these other laws that talk about sodomy, and I'm sure that part of this, these issues are being discussed at this conference. What I'm trying to get to in all of this is that over the last few years, in trying to understand the complexities of Islam around homosexuality, and then the larger question of religion and homosexuality, I unfortunately have become a little pessimistic. I do not think that gay people, many of us, can find affirmation in our religious texts. I don't think that within the Quran, for example, there can be a validation of homosexuality possible. I don't think that in any of our lifetimes the Vatican is going to come down and say that homosexuality is okay in the Roman Catholic Church. So perhaps in understanding that some of these last battles we need to have to do with religion, we also need to sort of understand that theological bickering can often be counterproductive, and that we might not find easy answers in these religious texts. Unfortunately, I really haven't also been able to find a particular solution. Talking specifically about a+Jihad+for+love, the film has now been seen in about 38 countries by more than 2 million people. And as it sort of looks at this question of the Quran and homosexuality, I think still it has been a powerful tool for people living in many Muslim countries. I get emails on Facebook from Iran, from Egypt, even from Saudi Arabia, where people have arranged for private screenings and been able to engage in discussions. So I think that what the film or what my work does is give the ability to people living in deeply religious communities to know that they are not alone. What I think it does not do, and perhaps I cannot do, is to say that that the Quran and the question of homosexuality can be reconciled, can come together. That pretty much is what I want to talk about. I hope to engage a lot in questions, and I would like to, if someone asks me, I would like to specifically talk about Iran, about Iraq, about Egypt, and what is going on in these countries, and I think it's very important. Also, DVDs of a+Jihad+for+love are available with me for sale, and I have to do this mini pitch, but you can contact me afterwards if you want one. Thank you.